Hey guys, this is the Caffeinated Medic. Welcome to the channel. And this video is going to be about cellular injury. So what exactly is cellular injury? Cellular injury, also known as cell damage, is defined as the effects of stress when the cell can't adapt to that specific stress. So what exactly do we mean by stress? Now, we already spoke quite a bit about stress in my previous video about cellular adaptation. If you haven't already watched that video, make sure you go and check it out. But basically, stress is anything that affects the functioning capacity of cells. Now, there are several types of stresses. Types of stresses are divided into two groups, internal and external. Examples of internal stress include genetic impairments within the cell's metabolism pathway, and examples of external stress include heat, radiation, or trauma. Now, cells like to be in homeostasis, and so they will respond to stress. However, this response depends on the type of cell, the severity of the stress, and the type of tissue that's affected. Generally, a cell would like to adapt to the stress. However, if the stress is too severe and the cell is not able to adapt, then the cell will be injured. This cellular injury can be reversible or irreversible. In this video, we'll look into hydropic change, fatty change, Hyaline degeneration as examples of reversible injury. We will also look into necrosis and apoptosis as examples of irreversible injury. So, without further ado, let's get into it. As usual, you can find the copy of the notes that I'm using down in the description box below. Just make sure you don't forget to subscribe and like the video. First, let's have a look at reversible injury, specifically cellular swelling. Now, the swelling of membrane-bound organelles is a hallmark of reversible injury, and cellular swelling, also known as hydropic change, is the most common form of cellular injury. And this is because almost all forms of stresses will lead to the impaired production of ATP. If a cell cannot produce ATP effectively, then all the ATP-dependent ion channels will not be able to function. This means that there will be an accumulation of sodium and calcium within the cell. And this is because the ATP-dependent sodium and potassium ion channels, as well as the ATP-dependent calcium ion channels, will not be able to function. It's important to note that the lack of ATP is not the only cause of increased calcium levels. Calcium is also stored within organelles, for example, mitochondria and endoplasmic reticulum. And so, if these organelles are damaged, they will release calcium, leading to increased amounts of calcium. Now, this accumulation of intracellular ions leads to an increase in osmolarity. And so, water will accumulate within the cell through osmosis. And this is what leads to cellular swelling. There are several signs of cellular swelling that can be observed. Internal organs such as the mitochondria and endoplasmic reticulum swell. The swelling of the endoplasmic reticulum leads to ribosomal detachment and therefore reduced protein synthesis. We can also observe small vacuoles of water within the cytoplasm as well as chromatin clumping within the nucleus. Finally, when we look at the cell membrane, we observe blebbing. And yes, blebbing is a scientific word. Now, if the cell had microvilli to increase the surface area, these microvilli will be lost, and so there will be a reduction in the surface area. All in all, cellular swelling is not a good thing. But hey, it's still reversible, as long as we remove the stress. Another hallmark of reversible injury is intracellular accumulations, and an excellent example is fatty change. When cells involved in fat metabolism, for example liver cells, are damaged, they are unable to adequately metabolize fat, and so this fat accumulates within the cells. Now, there are several causes of damage to liver cells, for example, alcoholism, starvation, obesity, diabetes mellitus, liver toxins, or drugs. So mild fatty change may have no effect on cellular function, but severe fatty change can result in abnormal enlargement of cells, and this may lead to complications. For example, if liver hepatocytes enlarge, they may compress the surrounding bile ducts, and this may lead to cholestasis. Another example of reversible injury is Hyaline degeneration. In connective tissue, we might have the accumulation of a homogeneous translucent material that stains intensely with acid stains. Acid stains appear bright pink on histology, and a good example of Hyaline degeneration is the walls of blood vessels seen in hypertension or diabetes mellitus. It's important to note that Hyaline degeneration is different from fibrinogen necrosis, which is cell death, although they may appear similar on histology, i.e. a bright pink color. We will discuss fibrinogen necrosis in a lot more detail in my next video about necrosis. Now, there are several different forms of cellular accumulations that we will not be going into detail in this video, but I am going to mention a few so that you have an idea. We can have the accumulation of cholesterol, and this becomes obvious with phagocytic cells undergoing atherosclerosis. Several different types of proteins may accumulate. We might have the accumulation of iron in a disease known as hereditary hemochromatosis. We have the accumulation of mucopolysaccharides in myxoid degeneration, and we might also have the accumulation of pigments like carbon in alveolar macrophages. You get the point, several different types of substances can accumulate within different types of cells in different conditions. Alright, we're done with reversible injury. The second type of cellular injury is irreversible injury. Irreversible injury can follow reversible injury if the stress persists, or irreversible injury can be a result of severe injury directly from normal cells. Now, as the name suggests, there's no coming back from irreversible injury, and cell death is inevitable. The real question is how. There are two main ways, necrosis and apoptosis. Both these processes are very important, and I will be diving into much more detail in separate videos for each of these processes. But basically, necrosis is a violent form of cell death that is not controlled and results in excessive inflammation, whereas apoptosis is controlled and a programmed form of cell death. In apoptosis, the cell shrinks and forms apoptotic bodies that are then engulfed by phagocytes, for example, macrophages. And this results in minimal inflammation, which is in contrast with necrosis, whereby the cell sort of explodes. Now, membrane damage is a hallmark of irreversible injury. There can be plasma membrane damage causing the release of intracellular components that leads to the excessive inflammation in necrosis. There may be mitochondrial damage that leads to the release of cytochrome C. And cytochrome C is an important player in apoptosis. And we could even have lysosomal membrane damage, causing the release of catabolic or digestive enzymes. Finally, the hallmark of cell death is the loss of nucleus. Now, there are three main processes by which cells lose their nucleuses: pycnosis, chirorhexis, and chirolysis. Pycnosis means condensation, and so the nucleus shrinks until it disappears. In chirorhexis, the nucleus is fragmented into tiny pieces, and in chirolysis, the nucleus fades away. Now, there can be several different types of necrosis, and we'll be talking about the different types in my next video. So stay tuned. That's all for cellular injury and cell death. Make sure you guys subscribe to the channel, like the video, and share this video with anyone that might find this useful. I also have an Instagram page, caffeinated.medic. Make sure you check it out for educational medical content. Thanks for watching. This is the Caffeinated Medic signing off. Till next time, take care.